think there's Eric in Nebraska called in. Are you there, Eric? Hello?
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
Alan?
Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Alan, this is a question a little bit off topic tonight, but I think you're the person who could help me. I've been trying to figure out how the very first king got the job as being a king, or the first ruler. I mean, going back farther back than Egyptian times when they had Ra, going back further than Sumeria, how did it all start where there was that key leadership position? And do you have any idea about how that might have come about?
Well, the general theory they give in universities is that an opposing tribe would clash at certain times over food in times of scarcity, and the biggest man, in fact, would be chosen to be a leader. He's more intimidating, etc. And during his little reign, during the time of strife, he would be looked up to for advice, etc. Then once the little skirmish was over, he got accustomed to having a little bit more than the rest and got accustomed to having all the goodies. That's what they claim, anyway. However, there's an occultic side behind it as well, because king comes from Cain, and kingu all comes from the same root word, including Cain also used to be the term for a ruler. The ruler that you use in school was made of Cain, you see? It was a measurement. So it goes back to a much ancient system, more ancient system of builders, again, to do with measurement, rulership. You measure by using the ruler, and you have a Cain. It became king and kingu. Sar is another term that they used in the Middle East for it as well. So it's an occultic language, in fact, going down through the millennia that still carries on today, which doesn't surprise me, since you look at the same emblems that they use in the nobility of Europe, and the same emblems that were used in coats of arms thousands of years ago. They try and say that it was all brought up during the Middle Ages. They invented the coats of arms, but that's so far from the truth, it's laughable. They found coins from 800 BC and before, well, around 800 BC when coins came in, with coats of arms of the particular kings, and they're always predators. It's always a lion or an eagle or something like that,
right?
Because they were the predators. So I don't know if that helps you or not.
But we are going back, you know, pre-Egyptian times, because the strongman theory wouldn't account for the intellect of the leader would only account for, you know, their strength and no one challenging them, but there had to be brain power.
Even in those days, they didn't need too much intellect. Physical strength was intimidating, and once you had the leaders, and this is the key to all this in history, once you had the leaders, the big men in all the big tribes, intermarrying with their daughters, etc., then the whole process of inbreeding started. And the priesthoods, which were always there in the early days, it was shamans of one form or another, would keep track of who was breeding with who, until you get to the stage of Sumer and then later Egypt, where they actually married their own sisters to keep this particular quality in the family. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah, so, I mean, it's tremendously interesting. And even the kings and queens they've dug up from Sumer are very interesting, because we find that they wore wigs of the people they ruled over, the black-haired wigs, but they themselves were blonde or red-haired. That's an interesting little fact. You go into the Egyptian tombs and look at even the aristocracy around the pharaohs. They were often painted with green or blue eyes, and they found the black woven wigs made by people, the local people, that they wore during the day when they were showing themselves to the public. There's a thing here that goes back and even into Aryan times to do with the blonde, the ancient blonde people, almost an albino, that swept through areas of the northern parts of the Middle East and then eventually into India. They were very proud of being ultra-white, almost albino. And that's where the whole concept of the Aryan race came from. Hitler was fascinated by that, as was Göring and a few other ones, and Himmler. They tried to trace their roots back to what they thought was the Aryan race, people who were highly skilled in war, very aggressive, almost merciless, in fact. And in the Old Testament, you'll find they call them the Hurrians at one point. In the Greek, they call them the Troglodytes. The Troglodytes, those who lived within caves, within mountains, very pale skin. And the supposed tribe of Manasseh interbred with them to the north and became very warlike and fierce and even turned upon the people of Israel, according to their legends. So we'll never know how much is truth or fiction or partly truth or myth. We do know that there was definitely a race of people who ruled over other peoples but did not interbreed with the ones they ruled over, much the same as the European royalty. They never marry into the ordinary stock which they rule over. They only marry each other. And from the most ancient times up until really the 1600s, we don't realize that in Europe, when a king married a foreign queen, often the whole country was put down as her dowry, and millions of people were handed over as property and all the land when they got together. That's what really happened not so long ago, not so very long ago at all. And here we find, lo and behold, Professor Carol Quigley, in his book, The Anglo-American Establishment, telling us that the next system that's coming in, it's already here, is a regurgitation of the feudal system, with the top CEOs being the feudal overlords. Now, I think there's Kirk in California. Are you there?
Yes, I am. How are you doing, Alan?
Not so bad.
Good, good. It's an honor to talk to you. I have a question for you. Who or has there been any obstacles in history that have conflicted against this agenda, like certain people that have come out in history that have actually managed to modify it at all?
I don't think so, to be honest.
Or groups, or, you know.
Well, there's always been groups that will spring up spontaneously and are often put down very swiftly if they're a threat to the ruling establishment. In fact, again, the history primarily of Europe was ferocious to do with how they kept control over the public, especially since the Norman invasion. Before the Normans, there were Saxons and various Germanic peoples in Britain. And in fact, the language was basically a Germanic language. And we know that they thoroughly resented being taken over by this new Norman brotherhood, really, with their old system that really goes all the way back to the ancient Middle East. We find Scotland was one of the main countries that rebelled and fought them off. Scotland fought off the Romans. It was the only country the Romans could not conquer.
Oh, really?
Yep.
I didn't know that.
Uh-huh. And, and even the defeats that Scotland had were mainly just uprisings of few clans. Scotland's biggest defeat was to be given away in marriage to royalty, from one royal to another. And we find that they put up some of the biggest shows. So did good parts of Ireland as well, rebelling against this particular system. People think in Ireland it's just Protestants against Catholics, and it wasn't just that at all. There were many Protestants fought even in the early IRA uprisings, because they did not want this this feudal British rule that was very, very ancient from taking over their lifestyles.
Well, yeah, they definitely portray it as it's the Protestants against the Catholics when it comes to Ireland. That seems to be the company line, if you will, I guess.
Yes, and they did definitely try and stir that up, because they think if they can get people fighting amongst each other, they sit back and laugh and manage the strife very well. It's the same in the Americas. I've noticed even amongst what they think are the patriot movements, the lines are being drawn as to who you're supposed to hate and kill and who's behind it. And that's typical strategy as you all go down the sewer pipe together, strangling the wrong people, because the ones above you are the guys. These are international families, very, very old families. And if you want to know a lot of their names, just look into who was on the Mayflower. May is a very important time for this occultic group.
Yeah, they certainly want us fighting amongst each other. I wonder if there's any agent provocateurs in this movement, too. I would imagine they try to plant some just to cause.
Some have come out and shown themselves. Colonel Bo Greitz was one of the best ones. He was on the shortwave programs for years, collecting names of all the people and being a good Mason, because he gave them all the Masonic clues, all those little talks. And then after 9/11, just when he got off shortwave radio a few months before, after being on it for years on the congressional steps on national television, he was shown talking to a reporter, and he said, "I think it was those crazy patriot types that listened to shortwave radio and and believe in black helicopters."
So you got to wonder what he did with all those names they collected, huh?
Oh, well, I'm sure it was so funny because he was telling them that as a member of the militia, which everyone could be, just send your name to the Department of Defense, and they'll give you an old Garand rifle from World War II.
Right, there you go. Something that's going to be worthless or blow up in your hands.
Yeah, well, at least they've got you monitored there, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if you saw the article. It was in Orlando, out of one of the television stations. They were talking about U.S. troops being deployed to the Washington, D.C.
Well, yeah. Actually, they rotate them to there anyway. They're always rotating them. They've been under heavy surveillance for a while in Washington and protection really since 9/11 happened.
Well, this one's kind of interesting because this is actually an armored division.
Yeah,
artillery.
Yeah, I'm not surprised because they're going to start the next step towards Iran.
Yeah, it definitely seems that way to me, that there's some really big things going on in the United States right now. And I'm just amazed because I talk to as many people as I can about these subjects, and I try not to be too pushy, but I am passionate about this, and I can see the writing on the wall, especially just all you got to do is read history. That's what I always tell people. I mean, this is not some conspiracy theory. All you have to do is read history. It's right there. It's fast for you.
Yeah, everything is in the open now if you want to see it. And the main thing is not to be stuck down on what's coming immediately next. Look at the long-term thing and everything suddenly makes sense.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And that's what I think gives you a perspective when you definitely look at history and stuff. Well, I know you got other people to talk to. It was a real honor speaking to you, Alan.
Well, thanks for calling in.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, there's Robert in Canada. Are you there, Robert? Robert in Canada? Hello? Robert? Robert in Canada? I don't know if I'm still on or if Robert's there, so I'll just keep talking away here. But look at the long-term goals of history, and everything suddenly makes sense to you. See where they're going. Look at the big building projects. Look at all the deals that are being signed for the next 5, 10, 20, 30 years. And you realize your government is not worried about losing any kind of war. Neither is the British government or the French or anybody else. They're doing their big long-term plans to deal with a rising population, to do with city planning, the habitat areas. That's going on full steam ahead. And when they stop doing that, then you start worrying, because then you'll know they're running out of things to do, because then they'll know there's something coming up. But in the meantime, don't be waylaid by the immediacy of things. Look at the long-term agenda. Look at the taking over of Iran as the next goal. And they might just very well rush through to Syria without stopping, because they don't want to stop it and then start to get public opinion again for Syria. It's interesting, even looking at George Orwell's 1984, where you had to know who you were fighting because they kept changing your targets every few months. That's how devious this system is. Well, I'll be back after the following messages.
Everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows.
Hi, I'm back. It's Alan Watt cutting through the matrix. And I think we have Robert in Canada on the line. Are you there, Robert?
Yes, I am, Alan. How are you?
Not so bad.
Oh, that's great. I just have a quick question for you, Alan. Recently, when you were on Red Ice with Henrik, you mentioned about the book Revelations and the meaning of holy, holy, holy.
Yeah.
wonder if you could just expand on that again, please.
Yeah, well, they're always laughing about the little clues that they put into books. And remember that all holy books have been rewritten down through the ages and updated, just like a computer's program, for the times ahead. And the Masons love, or at least the builders in those days, the Rosicrucians, love their little jokes. And they do run by the Kabbalah. They called it the Christian Kabbalah at one time when it came into Britain. They adopted it from the Middle East. And there's different versions, even in Greek. There's a Greek Kabbalah. But 666 is their big number, of course. We know that the name of the beast is 666. And Revelations, if you were to look at it, and you count up the numbers in the Kabbalah for holy, 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 you got 666. So right there it says, who are they worshipping? They're going round in a circle, all the different types of angels, etc. And what it's telling you there is the one that you're worshipping is the beast itself, 666.
That's very interesting. And so many interesting things in the Bible there that I guess have double meanings. Genesis, I believe, does it mean the gene of Isis?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole thing is very interesting because the high occultic society called their church the mother. They always call it the mother, sometimes Sophia, the goddess Sophia of wisdom.
Right.
And if you look at Osiris and Isis, well, you see Isis is the church and Osiris is the body. That's really what it means.
Mm-hmm.
You belong to the body of it. So the male lineage is supposed to be superior in their view to the female as far as rulership goes, but the female is the carrier of the gene. They call them dollies in the high Masonic circles,
mm-hmm.
and they mate them up. A dolly is a carrier. Mm-hmm. Benjamin Franklin used that term himself when he belonged to the Hellfire Club in England, and he talked about even the ancestor of Jackie Onassis, because that woman who ran the actual authorized high brothel, it's a breeding brothel, mm-hmm. with women with specialized genes, was Le Bouvier, Madame Bouvier, who was a direct ancestor of Jackie Onassis or Kennedy. So they've been breeding selectively down through the ages, and the honor for the high Masonic group who'd served the purpose well was to actually breed with these women.
Mm-hmm.
And it was their offspring they were after, offspring of genius coupled with the right carrier of the female.
Well, thank you for answering my question, Alan. You take care.
It's a pleasure. And, yeah, so much is going on all around us all the time. Always has been in every generation. Most people are oblivious to it. They don't really know what's going on, except what's right in front of their noses. And that's what the job of the media is to keep you in a total confusion while this agenda rushes ahead. Always learning, but never knowing. That's it for me tonight from Hamish and myself. It's good night, may your God or your gods go with you.